This track is always fucking late. We better not miss our flight, I swear to God. Ish is the sole reason that Hannah Miller had to go on in the nativity as the head of the donkey with no arse and back legs. She's always fucking late. God, she knows I get bad anxiety. Why does she always do this to me? I just know that Akbar will be waiting for me and I don't want to disappoint him. And I want everything to be perfect, like how I've been playing it in my head. He might be waiting in arrivals, wearing cool cotton because it's so hot. He'll be a gorgeous white suit and sunglasses, perched on top of his thick black hair, dabbing at his brow with a hanky. His heart will be pounding and his stomach will be full of butterflies just waiting to catch his first proper glimpse of me. His reward. He'll see me and he'll smile. And I'll drop my bags and run towards him. He'll take his arms and he'll kiss me like they do in Bollywood films. And he'll be banging and colours and fireworks. There will be fireworks, I just know it. Well, I guess I've had a boyfriend before. Harry. Well, if you can call him that. 12. The awkward brown girl from school can water salwa kameez to swimming lessons. Some boys would only look at me unless they were laughing at my stupid cotton suit flapping around me in the pool. They were much more interested in the beautiful white girls. They were allowed to wear short skirts and wear shiny lip gloss that they put them behind their desks in classes. I used to envy those girls so much. And I would lie awake at night long after the lights were off just picturing them. Imagining myself and my own earrings with my own necklaces and long silky blonde hair. Sit with all the boys at lunch as they stare at me, listening to every word I say. They were even allowed to wear perfume. They'd leave the sickly sweet smell of it in classrooms long after they'd walked out of them, and it smelled exciting and rebellious. Well, no wonder if the boys stared at them, I did too. I'd always wanted Rashid to notice me. You know, he was tall and handsome, had hair and a jawline like the Bollywood film stars. His mum used to chat to my mum in the Pakistani supermarket where they would chatter over fruits and vegetables, pressing their bony little fingers into mangoes to test their ripeness. Even if he did wear a stupid fucking trousers too high, the shirt was always blindingly white, I still liked him. He had a kind face. Bicarbonate of soda, that was it. His mum told my mum, keeps her white, it's really white, she said. He always kept himself to himself, you know. So he was never a target, I suppose. He never stuck up for me at school, neither. Even when they'd hold me down and bite holes in my coat, just kept his head down. The only person that didn't see me as the girl in the headscarf was Harry. He had floppy hair and yellow fingers from the cigarettes he would roll. We used to hold hands and walk home from school together, and later, I'd wait till the lights were out in the whole house, climb out the kitchen window, and he'd be waiting there, in the same place I'd left him. With his silly floppy hair and a grin. We would go and sit in parks, and he'd drink beer out of tin cans, and I met all his friends. They all lived on the estate off the park, and all of them had loads of brothers and sisters, and ate fish fingers and ham sandwiches for dinner. They were always really curious about me, and I liked it. They'd often run off to kick a ball around and get some more beers, so I'd get stuck with Fat Emily. Fat Emily was Tim's girlfriend, and she was fat. And always wore sleeveless tops. Shardy wings, my brother used to call them, because every fat auntie wore a sleeveless sari blouse at weddings and used to get a good eyeful of arm fat. Fat Emily asked me stupid questions all the time, you know, like making conversation about Pakistan when I'd never actually been. We used to nick a spare nick car from my house and go to Westfields, like, you know, Claire's accessories and that, nick stuff and hide it under our veils. I don't even have pierces, but I used to knit loads of earrings. Just fun. It'd been getting dark for the past hour. I mean, really dark. The kind of dark, you know, you feel like someone's watching you. I look at my watch, 10:20, 2 p.m. Harry was supposed to pick me up, like, nearly an hour ago. What the fuck was he playing at? I asked Fat Emily where the boys had gone. She gestures towards some bushes on the other side of the park. As I move closer, I hear a scuffle and some shouting. Follow the sounds into a little clearing where I see the boys huddled around at what I first thought was a pile of rubbish. I move closer and I see that it's a body curled up in a ball. Rashid, wearing his stupid white shirt that is stained red with blood. And as he writhes in pain, I watch the word Paki being carved into his forearm with a rusty key as the other boys hold him down. I think about my brother, how he got attacked on his way home from the mosque, how he wouldn't fight back, and so they broke four of his ribs and pissed all over his clothes. There isn't even a little bit of me that feels sorry for Rashid. I feel lifted. I feel powerful. And the smell of the blood and the little trickle running down his face is thrilling, and so is the way that I change the atmosphere instantly. They all stop to look at me, waiting for me to move or speak. Harry tries to say something, open his mouth, and makes a weird croaky noise. I can still see Rashid's face now. He's asking me not to hurt him. He's begging me to tell him to stop, saying he knows I'm not like them. It's when I realise that he's right. I'm not like them. But I'm nothing like him either. I grab his hand and I bite down hard, hard on his fingers, and he lets out gut-wrenching screams which ring in my ears again and again and again. I taste metal and I feel his breath on the side of my face, and adrenaline rushes through my entire body. As I take Harry's hand and walk away from him, I spit little bits of soft flesh and blood into the ground. Ish had cold feet. I knew she fucking would. Well, I had the same thought last night. Better tell Bushra that we're setting off. We found her on the comments page about the EDL protest in Walthamstow, where that thing happened to Mr. Sharif. Mr. Sharif was a man who owns the shop where my dad picks up the paper every morning. He was one of Dad's first mates when he came to this country. During the protest, he got pulled over the counter, got his head kicked in, was chucked out onto the roadside, and people took photos of him on their phones. My dad was really shook up, didn't he, for a week. Locked himself in his study. I became absolutely obsessed with the attack. It was all I could think about for weeks, and no one in my house would talk about it. Why did they target him? Did he say something to him? Did he fight back? Well, it took me a long time to realise that it wasn't about Mr. Sharif. He probably didn't do or say anything to them at all. Beating him up was part of something much, much bigger. I was looking at all the reports of it online, and Bushra was there in the comments, posting about four of the Muslim girls to chat. These were girls like me that had no one. They were bullied at school, they were stared at in their headscarves and looked at like they didn't belong, but together we realised we didn't have to be the victims. These girls were getting out of it and actually doing something about it, and everyone here now knows who they are and are listening to what they have to say. She came from the UK too, so she's been really helpful with how to hide it and, you know, sort out her flights and stuff, and she's getting someone to meet us in Turkey. We haven't been told anything about where we're going or who we're meeting in case we get stopped and questioned. It's quite exciting, really. Oh yeah, she also created the Zora Foundation, which me and Nish have been practicing recipes for a few weeks now so we can be ready. And she even told us to delete all our Facebook photos, except our favorite ones, as that's where they will get the photos of us for the newspapers. She's been giving us good advice about that too, you know, media and stuff. Well, they just lie and lie, don't they? I think about Rashid quite a lot. Not because I care, because I fucking don't, but because you do stuff like that and people remember. Rashid, you ignored me all the way through school, but I bet you remember me now, don't you? I don't reckon you'll ever forget me. My mum made me walk to and from school with my brother for weeks after that. Thought someone would attack one of us too and carve something into our skin, as if what we were wasn't obvious already. She's always been weak, my mum. Her anxiety about being approached or judged makes her near too invisible, especially after my brother and then Mr. Sharif got beaten up. I reckon that's why I suffered at school, you know? I was so ashamed of myself. I was dancing my mum's steps. I used to find my veil embarrassing, but I didn't understand it back then. And I didn't understand the power that it gives me. I'm sick of people saying, you know, oh, looking at me, like, you poor dears, if I'm held down every morning to have a piece of cloth tied around my fucking head. When I'm in full niqab, I am fucking powerful. All black, solid, oozing power. If anything, makes you notice me more. And I want to be seen. I deserve to be seen. Well, that's what Akbar always says to me. Sometimes, though, I think I couldn't possibly do it. You know, months and months of building a new life for my computer, and it's here. The day is finally here. Sometimes I think that maybe I'll just put a spoon in my knickers, you know, so I won't have to tell them that I've changed my mind, but they'll never let me on the plane. They'll take me to a side room away from Ish, and when I beep under the metal detector, I'll tell them everything, and they will send me back home. Back to the familiar. But I now know that there is nothing here for me. I'm invisible at school, I'm invisible at home, just like my mum, and now I know I have a purpose to serve, and it isn't shuffling behind her in fear for the rest of my life. People treat us like the bad guys. Why should we be the bad guys? If I die, people know about it, and anything is better than being hated, humiliated, and staying here. My dad has been doing a countdown to the general election on the kitchen calendar. 3 days left. He tells me, Khadija, when people are scared, they go far right. People are terrified, and it's our responsibility to be the good Muslims. To hold our heads up and stand beside our people in this country to make sure we are heard too. Well, you know what? I'm fucking scared too. And I refuse to be another Paki that's attacked on the streets and forgotten about. I am going to take action, and I will definitely be heard. Ish, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I'll meet you at the bottom of the corner.